Welcome to Italian Innovators. I'm Luca Cottini, and today I'm in the company of Michael Moore, freelance translator, interpreter, and author of a wonderful English version of Alessandro Manzoni's masterful novel, The Betrothed, that was recently published. It was the first in 50 years. Thank you, Michael, for being with us today. It's a real pleasure to have you in the show.
Thank you, and it's sort of nice to talk about the novel and my work in this context of Italian innovators.
So today we'll investigate the Italian character through the characters of the nation's most celebrated novel, the Promessi, Sposi, the Betrothed, by the 19th century writer Alessandro Manzoni. We'll explore the American reception of the book and the contemporary revival of interest during the pandemic. And we'll talk about the added value of a good translator for a brand, as well as for cultural and political diplomacy. Now, Manzoni's masterpiece is a book of love, faith, and politics. Set in the Lombardy of the 17th century, the novel narrates the story of two humble lovers, Renzo and Lucia, whose marriage plans are disrupted by a powerful local nobleman. And the story follows their difficult path of maturation in the midst of all sorts of difficulties as they grow in faith and love for each other. Now, the novel is also a linguistic experiment, as Manzoni aimed to offer a model of written Italian prose, as well as a standard language for the newly formed Italian nation. The book acquired a political dimension, setting a providential interpretation of Risorgimento, so the process of Italian unification, and de facto becoming the nation's novel after unification as a mandatory reading in the Italian school curriculum, and it still is. As an American scholar trained in Italian studies, what caught your attention in the book? What elements of the Italian DNA does the book capture, in your opinion?
The first thing that always captures me as a translator is the language itself. You know, even beyond plot, beyond characters, the language itself is very spellbinding for me. So, and I've always been interested in the evolution of the Italian language. I mean, in my academic studies, starting with Dante and the De Vulgari Eloquentia, I did my dissertation on Bembo and how Bembo sort of wrote the Italian grammar. And so I was very interested in this idea, first of all, of someone creating modern Italian. And then the story itself, I mean, I lived in those areas. I actually, you know, I lived in Milano, I lived in Como, but I didn't read the novel until I came back to the States, you know, after 8 years in Italy. And I came back and I was doing Italian studies and I was just captivated by it as a novel. The story itself, the locations, the descriptions of the, you know, landscape in Lombardia. I mean, it's just, it's a breathtaking story. And I think it's also a fresco, really, of Italian society.
We have to remind that, like, the Italian language is really a construction that came out over the centuries from first kind of models of written language. You mentioned Dante and Bembo during the 16th century. And then, of course, Manzoni, who offered the greatest model of modern Italian. But also, it's a language that developed later on in the 20th century through television and radio as a spoken standard language, because then normally in Italy, people would speak like a very dialectal or regional variety of Italian. So in this sense, Manzoni gave a contribution and proposed for the school system a model of modern written Italian.
Yeah. When we consider the time in which he wrote this, he began in the 1820s, right? He first published in 1827 and then did his final version 1840-42. And at that time, first of all, a large percentage of the Italian population was illiterate. And the language, the mother tongue of most Italians, was the dialect that they spoke in their local area, in their region. And he was very interested in having a national standard. He himself was from Milano. So even for Manzoni himself, Italian was a foreign language. I mean, he spoke, obviously, Lombardo. He wrote fluently in French. And he did learn Italian, but the Italian he learned and the Italian that had been standardized as a literary language was really old. I mean, it was rooted in the 14th century in Dante, and things had changed. So he wanted written Italian to be closer to spoken Italian, which is still an issue today, though, I have to say. Having worked in Italian bureaucracy, I'm wondering, wow, how can anyone understand, you know, some of these instructions, and especially coming from the government? So he wanted the written language to be closer to the spoken language, and he wanted a national standard, a language that everyone in Italy would be able to use. His novel is written and sort of emerges as a national epic during this period of Italian unification, the sort of slow period over the sort of three wars of independence that we could talk about. He was very involved in that, not politically so much, but certainly an Italian patriot. And I've been asking myself this question. I don't know if you know the answer, but when did we even start calling Italian Italian?
That's a very good question. I have to say, Manzoni is a great figure in establishing an Italian language, but also in establishing an Italian common imagination. In the sense that, like, and we might relate this to something similar that happened in the United States with Hollywood, that really created a shared imagination of what being American means for a population that came from all parts of the world and didn't have in common anything but the hyphen American, so Italian Americans, Japanese Americans, Irish Americans. And so Hollywood and literature, cinema in this case, gave a platform of common imagination. And Manzoni's novel gave these different cultures, this cheap puzzle of identities, the peninsula was a common platform, a common ground, a common story. I wanted to ask you, what are your favorite characters or scenes?
The issue of the Italian, of how the novel sort of shapes the Italian character is interesting because, of course, people read it at a very early age and sometimes they read it repeatedly, even three times throughout their, you know, required school experience. And some have called the novel a kind of epic of the Italian character, you know, a sort of coming of age of the Italian people, because you sort of, everyone can sort of see themselves in some characters. There are different model behaviors, models of good behavior, models of bad behavior. To be honest, I mean, some of my favorite characters, the bad characters. I think that the Nun of Monza is a fascinating character just because it's a deep psychological study of how a young girl was forced into the convent. It's a portrait of the way many Italians were sort of forced into lives that they did not want, because it's very much a novel about justice and injustice. Some of my favorite characters, you know, there are so many, but I'm particularly fond of Renzo, who I see as a kind of the entrepreneurial character. I think that professors of literature tend to criticize him, and I don't really understand. Yes, he does make mistakes, but without Renzo, first of all, there would be no novel. But he's a self-made man. We're introduced to this character. We don't know too much about his backstory. You know, I mean, we know that he's an orphan, but so he doesn't come from money. He's very hardworking. But even in this era, he's set aside enough money. He's bought himself like a little piece of land. He has a skill, you know, in weaving, you know, in the silk trade. And so he's able to sort of build a livelihood for himself. And he's constantly having to think on his own two feet. He has no education. He's illiterate. And I would add one of the great innovations of the novel, in not just in an Italian context, but in a European context, is having at the center two peasants, not two nobles. Up until then, you know, literature was, first of all, written in the language of the upper class and written about either mythological figures or princes. And Manzoni, no, he places at the center two simple people, two peasants. And I think there at the center, Renzo and Lucia sort of embody aspects of the Italian character, the one aspirational, the man who's always trying to sort of move forward and trying to find an active solution. And Lucia, an interesting character who many people, sort of women especially, project themselves onto her as sort of like being quiet in the background, but trying to think of a way to get things done to sort of achieve her ends without upsetting the apple cart too much. Don Abbondio might be the most prototypically Italian character because he embodies the art of getting by, di arrangiarsi. Again, you know, there are these various characters, I would say, that don't want, they are not revolutionary, okay, in the way we might almost want them to be. You know, when you talk about the sort of providential sense of the novel, I think it's in that, this kind of not believing that things are going to change radically, but just trying to keep things at an even keel. And when we think about the Italian character, I like to use the image maybe of an Italian town, the small village, because what I learned from my years of living in Italy and in working in an Italian office was that you have to learn to get along. In America, you know, you have a fight with someone, you move along. Italians know there you are in that same place. And there is this deep attachment to place that is typically Italian character. And this need to somehow find a modus vivendi, you know, a way of getting along. There are so many characters.
But of course, Rodrigo, who is the powerful lord.
Right, he's definitely not a favorite of mine. I mean, there are certain small characters that I really like. I like Agnese, you know, the mother of Lucia, who's always plotting a little bit. She's very, very funny, too, but very relatable, because obviously in bringing this into English, I had to think of American counterparts. And I thought of my grandmother. I thought of my aunts and stuff a little bit, you know, people from small towns in America, things that were relatable. But definitely very Italian characteristics in a way. Fragaldino, to me, is a charming character because he stops by, he wants to get the chestnuts, and he starts telling stories, you know? He goes on and on. So I think that there are many characters that are typical of the small town. But I think that the one episode that, to me, sort of illustrates maybe the dark side of the Italian character, but the kind of pressures that people are under and the way they have to cave to pressure is in chapter 19, when you have the meeting between the Conte Zio, the uncle of who is a count of Don Rodrigo, and the Padre Provinciale, the provincial father of the Capuchin orders, where basically they want to get the good guy, you know, they want Fra Cristoforo, who is helping Renzo Lucia, who's also a Capuchin monk, and they want to get him out of the way. And there's this fascinating meeting between the two, which is orchestrated in a way that reminds me so much of Italy. You know, you begin by having a big dinner, pretending that it's celebrating this guy, but clearly he's not asking for a favor at all. He is sort of making a demand. And there was that idea. I had trouble translating the word impegno. Ah, è un impegno is something that the Father Provincial realizes why this big dinner has been held in his honor. And it's in order to extract a commitment from him to get Fra Cristoforo out of the way, to transfer him to another parish. Mm-hmm. And that's that long conversation that just, where everything is between the lines. Nothing is said explicitly. There's this threat that's underlying the whole conversation between the two men. And of course, you know, the Padre Provinciale, who is, I guess we don't know too much about him, but we should assume that he's a good man, but he is forced to make a very unpopular decision. And he kind of justifies it to himself, saying, well, you know, this guy is a troublemaker. He doesn't get into the details of the case at all about what is right or wrong. He just thinks of convenience. You know, that is also a side of life in Italy, an unfortunate side maybe, but I think a reality that Italians will recognize. Yes. And that Italians will certainly recognize in a negotiation, you know. It's not about winning or losing all the time.
In a way, I would say, well, the novel is an operatic representation of this world in all its intricacies and complexity, a world that is not explained, but it is shown and that everybody can recognize. So in this sense, characters embody certain personalities, or in design terms, they would be prototypes of certain psychologies or certain temperaments. I like to emphasize the nature of literature as this space where we recognize, where we see something that everybody already knows, but we need to see it to recognize it. Like in a prototype, you show a shiny object that reveals much more than its mere explanation. Were we to do like a psychology profile, it wouldn't touch us in the same way as, or the same enthusiasm that you showed for these characters. In this context, I want to move to the American reception of Manzoni, who did not receive much acclaim in the United States, despite a relatively positive early review by Edgar Allan Poe in 1835. Now, can you tell us why and what moved you now to undertake the monumental work of this new translation after 50 years from the last version?
You know, I could only make a hypothesis about why it hasn't done better. Although, you know, in the 19th century, all things considered, it didn't do badly. You know, it was, when we look at Longfellow, you know, who is well known for his translation of Dante, he was a reader of Manzoni. It was included early on in the Harvard classics. Like in America, this notion emerged of great books that had to be read. And Harvard had a whole series of great books, and Manzoni was among them. I think some people might think that religion was a cause, you know, that it was such a Catholic novel that it didn't really jive with the sort of American a Protestant ethic. My explanation is really simpler, which is that I think that the previous translations were very flat. It's true that the novel does not have a huge overarching story, you know, like some of the great historical novels of the period. But it's also true that the Italian did not emerge as a powerhouse, I think, in the literary establishment, you know, in the publishing industry until relatively late. So many Italians arrived that were illiterate. They did not have access to the English language. So I don't think that they were quite there to promote their own culture to the extent that the French and the Germans were. I think the Germans particularly then followed by the French. And up until recently, that was certainly the case in whatever foreign literature we saw translated. My interest in this was, I think it sort of goes actually to the core of my vocation as a translator, which is to somehow communicate Italy to Americans, to somehow express things that I find fascinating in a language that Americans can understand. I think some of that comes also from my family background. My father was in sales. And so, you know, he sort of instilled in us. I mean, we're a large family and he was teaching sales techniques. He was an engineer. And then and he was with a multinational company, which had a branch in Italy, in Milano, which sort of helped my arrival in Italy. And he would sit us around the table at dinner. He would instruct us in sales techniques, in how to speak and how to express yourself, how to be clear, how to be rhetorically effective. And I think to me, this sort of the novel sort of epitomized what I've been trying to do, what I've tried to sort of take something that I read and that I love and communicate that fully to an American audience. You know, I think it is something also, which is kind of the culmination of my career as a translator, because it took all of the various kinds of work that I've done, both in a literary context and in a political context and a commercial context, and put it all together, because it's an encyclopedia, really, this novel. I mean, in addition to the story, in addition to the lyricism, there's a lot of botany, there's a lot of politics, there's a lot of history, especially. And I think that it sort of drew upon all of my resources as a translator to do.
From what you said, like a couple of extra observations. First, that the novel is a communication, is a form of communication. Storytelling has to do with the creation of value. So in the way we tell a story, we create value over something. This might apply also for a brand, a product, or political communication. This is something we'll discuss in a few minutes. The second observation is that the work of a translator is, and we'll also talk about this, is really this craft, this ability to transpose the score of a story in another instrument, in another language. And when you were talking, I had in mind one of my favorite musicians. His name is Drew Henderson. You can find on YouTube his work. He's a guitarist who transposes the masterpieces of classical music. I think of the Raindrop by Chopin or like the Seventh Symphony by Beethoven through the guitar. And this ability to remake a masterpiece, to convey new life to it by adopting a new instrument, a new language, is really the key for a translation that doesn't go flat. That is really a wonderful way to read the novel. The translator is a reader that is engaged in redoing the novel to make it come alive again. In a way, as readers, we do the same. I also wanted to emphasize how during the pandemic, really, the novel became a point to read our own contemporary reality. Actually, the pandemic sparked a new wave of interest in Manzoni's novel, especially in light of the representation of the bubonic plague of Milan in 1630. This circumstance really made explicit the nature of literature as a form of fictional knowledge that really wants to read reality, test situations beforehand, and grant the inner vision of things beyond their behind their facade. So how did Manzoni help you read the pandemic? And in which way do you think literature can become a tool for building and reading international relationships?
Yeah. Manzoni also had a vocation as a historian. His account of the plague is completely non-fictional. You know, there's nothing fictional about his representation of the plague. And he was criticized, actually, during his life by Goethe, you know, the German romantic and author. I think it was very creepy, in a way, the fact that what he was writing about, he was writing about events that had taken place 200 years earlier as a way of talking about the problems in the Italy of his own time. He was talking about a pandemic that entered and was exasperated, really, by foreign occupation, by the fact that the German imperial troops, or I should say the Austro-Hungarian imperial troops, came in bringing with them the plague. And throughout, this entire novel is framed against the historical background of the War of Succession of Mantua. So you see an area, it's not even in Italy at this point, he's only talking about, you know, about Milano, as you know, the state of Milan, which is roughly corresponding to the Lombardia of today. So he is engaged in a kind of sustained historical and political criticism when he talks about the plague. And I think that that really sort of brought out aspects, mirrored what was happening today, because we saw many of the same things that he described. We saw, first of all, the reluctance to admit that a plague, in our case, that COVID had arrived. We saw that it was brought in by, you know, foreign visitors. In his case, he was talking about soldiers. In our case, we were talking about visitors coming from China and visitors coming from Europe. And Italy, certainly, we look at what happened in Lombardy and Bergamo, in the richest areas of Italy, too, for that part. I think Manzoni definitely gives a historical and a political context to the plague rather than an epidemiological one, because the science is there. And the fact that people could not accept the science was the fault of politics, something which we still see happening today. So I think, first of all, it was creepy in a sense, but it also pushed me a little bit further along in making sure that my language was modern. Because sometimes I think that a fault in some translations, especially in dealing with a classical work, is that they're almost slavish, you know, that they're so interested in capturing every little nuance that they end up creating an English that is very artificial. And I think to, you know, get up in the morning and turn on the radio and hear expressions and situations that mirrored exactly what I was reading in the novel was very helpful in making these pages even more vivid.
And of course, a great translator is like a great tailor that can seamlessly fashion a new attire with stitches that are as effective as they are apparently invisible. Also, as a great conductor, a translator can faithfully reinvent the piece, but maintaining and at the same time enlivening its core. Now, you already hinted at it, but what does the art of translation consist of for you?
I think it has to be sort of almost like breathing. I like the idea of writing being very natural, but I also am a great believer in eloquence, in language being original and in being fresh. Each book is different, I think. So if I were to say what is translation for me, first of all, it is a constant self-examination, self-analysis. It is my relationship to Italy, my relationship to the Italian language. Me as a 20-year-old going to Italy without much Italian and living there and not in any kind of organized program, but sink or swim, having to learn the language and having to sort of figure out where I was and having completely underestimated the situation in which I lived. And I think my entire life after has been trying to sort of understand those first experiences, understand Italy more deeply. I've been involved in so many different contexts, I would say, from school as a student, then I taught at a high school in Italy. I came back here, then I was in a high sort of academic area. And then suddenly I was working with businesses, I was working with cultural figures, and I was working with Italian politics at the highest level. For me, it really has become my vocation in a way. And the vocation is, how can I explain all of this to myself, I have to say? You know, how can I understand Italy even better?
It's really beautiful what you said, because this is also the trajectory of every researcher in a way. Something that happens at the beginning that sparks questions that last over a lifetime. There are not just questions that are solved in a minute, but they require the full commitment of a lifetime to be unfolded. And this is really beautiful. Now, you also worked on translations from Italian of works by Primo Levi, Alberto Moravia, Sandro Veronesi, Henri De Luca, Nicola Gardini, Fabio Genovesi, to name a few. What is your method of work?
It changes from book to book, I have to say. I mean, in general, I would say I do like to translate swiftly a first time, just to sort of, you know, almost the way that I speak. I like to translate quickly, and then difficult words that trouble me, I'll maybe highlight them and then go back and look at them later. I don't like spending too much time with a dictionary. And I find that words that I look up in the dictionary, I never remember what they mean. And I go back again and again and again. And it's sort of like going back to my first experiences in Italy, that what stuck in my memory were things that I sort of intuited the sense of, you know? And so I work that way, and then I go back. Now, With Manzoni, obviously that didn't work, you know, because there's no swift way of doing it. So I think that there was lots and lots of research. A lot depends upon the type of novel and how swiftly you can go. Doing Primo Levi was very difficult because he was writing the work that I did, The Drowned and the Saved, and you could sense that this was a deeply depressed man. In fact, shortly after he finished the novel, he committed suicide. And you couldn't move quickly through it. I mean, there was something leaden about it, something sad. And there's only so much sadness that you can bear as you work. The work by Fabio Genovese was the first funny novel that I did. And I found that very liberating because if you're doing something funny, it has to be funny. And if you're just being very literal, it's not going to be funny. You have to land the joke. And I found that very freeing in terms of translating in a way that is faithful, not just to the letter, but to the spirit in which something is done. Doing subtitles for films is something that I've also done and enjoyed a lot because, first of all, because I was working with other people, and that's a lot of fun where you start debating what words mean. And do you say cash on the barrel, cash on the barrel head? I remember having a big discussion. I'm like, that's what they say in Brooklyn, not in Massachusetts. So we would have big debates. So that was fun, but it was also fun because we had to, in the smallest possible space, that little line at the bottom of a screen, communicate a lot. That was very, very helpful when it came to doing dialogue and stuff. So there isn't a single method. I think in terms of what I want, yes, I don't want it to look like a translation. I want the reader to have the same pleasure in reading in English that I might have or that an Italian reader would have in reading the original. And so if the language is very high and lyrical, then it should read that way. If it's funny, it should read that way. If it's short and brutal, I would say, for example, Ph.D. de Luca writes in these short, brutal sentences. I translated it that way. And I was it was funny, an Italian writer friend of mine said, the problem is that if you translate De Luca accurately in English, people will say that you speak English badly because he writes in such a peculiar Italian. So I try to capture what exactly it is that that writer does with language.
If there is a fil rouge, like a line in what you said, is that like really translating is not an imitative word, but more of an embodied word, something yeah. like what an actor would do, the ability to give voice and body to the words and to the authors that come up on your desk from time to time. Now, you also worked for years as the official interpreter for the Italian delegation at the United Nations, writing and translating foreign policy statements, editing texts for publication, and interpreting for Italian leaders during their visits to New York. So how did your attitude change in such a different context? And how do you give immediate voice in a channel of communication to political meetings?
I started working there in August of 1993 until 2 years ago. And if you sort of think of the changes in Italian politics since then, there have been many, you know, I wouldn't say a title change. It's just been one change after the other. So I began work and we still had the Christian Democrats, you know, and you still had the socialists and you still had the Italian Communist Party. The first thing that changes is, of course, I have my own politics, but you cannot impose them upon someone that you're interpreting for. So I had to learn to speak in the language of various people. And I also had to learn who some of these leaders were. You know, I mean, there's one image that you see in the newspaper. And then to find out who they are actually in private, in a certain sense, as you meet them, as you try to develop some kind of rapport. I remember D'Alema in particular. He came under a lot of very unfair criticism. And many silly things were said in the press about him flirting with Condoleezza Rice, which is complete nonsense invented by the Italian papers. And here instead was this very serious politician. He was one of the few that, like, you know, came with his wife, and on his break, he didn't want to do the big luncheons. He just wanted to take a walk with his wife. And he was very nice to common people and stuff. And you would sort of see who had the common touch. Renzi, of course, had the common touch. You know, he just loved walking out and being greeted by the crowds and stuff, and was very friendly and went around the office meeting everyone. You meet other people who are very standoffish. And as an interpreter, of course, their language changes a lot from the certain, if I think again of D'Alema, a certain style of the leftist speaking in very long, elaborate, and somewhat indirect ways. Sometimes I'd almost be wondering whether or not they had understood the question and when were they going to get to the point. But, you know, I sort of had to follow that flow. And often figures of the right are attractive because of their very short, emphatic sentences, which are almost hard to interpret because you have no time to even catch a breath, and because they're so frontal sometimes. They can be very brutal in what they say, and that's not my own personal style. So I had to adapt my language style to many, many different types of people. The other thing, though, that I really appreciated was how, despite political differences among certain figures, I would give you the example of a couple of undersecretaries of state who had to work on the issue of Somalia. One belonged to the extreme left party, Rifondazione Comunista, and the other to the extreme right, Alleanza Nazionale. They succeeded each other. But they both had the same deep dedication to the case of Somalia, and they were never tired of sort of bringing it to the attention. Again, these are political opposites, but with an equal passion for Somalia in this particular case. So I came to see the private person behind the public person. I think my job was very much to find an effective way of selling in a certain sense. Sometimes you did have to tone things down, because sometimes these politicians would come with a kind of speech written for domestic consumption, I would say, that just would not play out well on the international stage, especially in the earlier stages, I think.
You meet them in the space of their vulnerability, as you were mentioning, because at home things mean something, but in an international context, the audience might vary. And so that's why you need someone who gives voice, true voice, to what you want to say.
I would also add that you would see how, no matter what stature someone might have in Italy, what happens when they come to New York and what happens when they come to the United Nations? Do they have that same stature? Some people that, Susanna Agnelli, absolutely no problem, of course, old socialist, very comfortable in any environment. But others could not wait to get back on the plane to go back to Rome. They were clearly uncomfortable being like a small fish in a big pond, as opposed to being a big fish in a small pond.
This happens in the same way for entrepreneurs who might be the big lords in their small pond, like Don Rodrigo's, if you want. When they come to a larger market, like the American market, might have a hard time conveying the value of their products or simply establishing a channel of communication, which is not just speaking the English language, but really owning or embodying what they want to say in English as a mindset. So why do brands need experienced translator? Why is not enough to translate a phrase in English to speak to an American audience? And why do we need cultural translators?
It's a very good question. I mean, I think of some experiences where I was only brought in at the last minute, either because people hadn't realized that they needed an interpreter and things were already at a breaking point, maybe between the Italian producer and the American distributor. The Italians often have an excellent product, but how are you going to sell that? I always think of the old philosophical question, if a tree falls in the forest and no one hears it, did it make a noise, right? And I think, how do you make a noise? Sometimes someone will come with a sort of Italian sales mentality, and they'll have a slogan, and they'll have a whole campaign built for an Italian audience that just doesn't work. It'll be built around slogans, words, or expressions that sound sexy in Italian that just are not going to fly here. I even think in a political context, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, now they're called Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation, they became enamored of this expression, il sistema paese. How are we going? And they even have like a department of that. How do we translate that? And I say, we went back and forth and back and forth. I'm not sure that we ever really solved that one effectively. That was for domestic consumption. I had to work on the catalog for Expo Milano, and to correct it because it had been translated by a team of translators, some with Google Translate. But the whole idea was this was a catalog meant for the investors. And they had produced this horrible, mishmash of languages, again, built around slogans. So I think that you have to build a clear narrative. You cannot fall in love with these sort of slogans, which I find that Italian advertising tends to do that. I suppose American does, but maybe I'm less aware of it. But you sort of have to realize you're going to have to rethink your approach. You are going to need good interlocutors. You should listen to the advice that you're getting, which not everyone is willing to do. Because you often have, very small companies making a great product. And that's fine. But sales is sales. That's another matter. And do you want to start producing things to scale, first of all? How are you going to continue to guarantee the same quality as you build up to scale as well? And how are you going to sell? And that's, I think that interpreters and translators, I would say, particularly play a very important role in not just translating the words, but again, trying to get across the message in a way that's effective and find to find the right rhetoric to sell something. So it's sort of like it's going beyond translation, but it's very much a part of what I consider translation.
We go back to your Promessi sposi. Yeah. How do you make noise about a great idea? You can be protective of your own idea, or you can accept to navigate an uncharted territory of someone who might say your idea in a completely different voice. But that uncharted territory is where actually the communication happens and the magic of the communication or storytelling happens. They are not in the restricted area where we own control.
There's also a sales aspect to that. You know, when you propose a book to a publisher, you have to learn to do what they call the elevator pitch, to be able in really 1 minute, in one sentence or two or three sentences to sell your idea, which can be very frustrating. And I know it's frustrating for Italians who like to have a long sort of drawn out way of explaining thing and say, no, you don't have all that time. Can you sell this idea in the first 30 seconds, you know, without making the other guy yawn, you know? And I've had to do that with a novel, really. And sometimes I just say, it's the great Italian novel. I mean, what are you going to say without minimizing? I mean, you have to have that sort of way of pitching something, but without sort of depriving it of its quality.
What you described with regard to your work, that is the ability to acquire a personality, acquire a different profile, is key also in entrepreneurial terms. The ability to speak the language of different customers, of a clientele that is very diversified, especially now with the digital age. This is a key ability to hone.
And I would add also, as an American, I guess, that you have to also come here with deep respect for Americans. I think that maybe because of the years in which I lived in Italy, there tended to be this kind of simplification of who Americans were. Like they said, we have no culture, we have no history, we have no taste. It's very offensive, first of all. And if that's your attitude, just somehow you need to wash your brain of all of that. And you do have to come here with respect for Americans and who we are. And to realize that there are people who are quite expert and quite refined in their tastes and what they want and in their style of living.
Absolutely. In order to know, love is a prerequisite. Before criticizing, you have to know. But in order to know, you need to love.
I would also add, I also taught Italian, for, beginners in different universities. And, when you look at who was studying Italian, only a small percentage were Italian Americans. You had Koreans, you had Jewish people, you had Irish, Polish, people fascinated by Italy for many, many different reasons. So it's not just this idea of Italian Americans being interested in Italian culture, but many people from, across the board.
Yeah, allowing this patrimony to become even more diversified and to speak to more diverse pools of people.
Very cosmopolitan. I think it is important to be cosmopolitan. And Italy has actually this sort of, apart from the whole sort of provincial, core, I think, of things Italian, Italian is also very cosmopolitan culture, which is why it communicates so well with others, I think.
Fantastico. Well, thank you very much for this enlightening conversation, really. We examine Italian culture from the perspective of its greatest novel and explore the value of translation as a creative and faithful reinvention, or as a mindset of continuous dialogue and understanding among cultures, as we were saying a few minutes ago. So thank you, Michael, for your time and, of course, for your work.
Thank you, Luca.
Thanks, everybody, for watching. If you like this presentation, I invite you to subscribe to this channel or to the newsletter on the webpage of the show at www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications on new episodes and know more about the project. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or on Instagram at Italian Innovators for updates, news, and additional materials. Thanks for your support. Arrivederci e alla prossima.